in regular rings.
I would like now to get to the formulation which works in principle for all groups and all rings, but this needs some preparations I will start with. The first preparation is classifying spaces for families, which is anyway a very interesting topic in its own right, and it's worthwhile learning something about this. So we start with a group. As before, this is discrete. Actually, many of the things I'm saying right now in the beginning do make sense, are very interesting for topological groups as well, but I would like to confine myself to something more elementary. So what is a family of subgroups? Is a set of subgroups. Which is closed under conjugation and passed into subgroups. So it means obvious thing, if H in it and the conjugate is in it, and if K is a subgroup of H and H is an F, then K as well. For us, the examples are the following, and I hope that the notation in principle explains what the examples are. So TR stands for trivial, so the family contains of just one group, which is a trivial group. This stands for finite cyclic. Fin stands for finite subgroups. Cyclic stands for all cyclic subgroups. This stands for virtually cyclic. And all stands, surprisingly, for all subgroups. And the point is that if we have such a family, we can construct to it what is called a classifying space. Let me give the definition first. So a model for the classifying space of a given family of subgroups is what is called the GCW complex. And if you're not happy with the GCW complex, think of it as a CW complex with a nice G action, or of a simplicial complex with a G action, or just as a nice G space. That's also okay. Should not be too wild. And the notation is usually that you remember the family and the group like this. Now comes the main property. You want to make some conditions about the fixed point set, depending on the family. And fixed point set should either be contractible, if H belongs to F, and should be empty otherwise. Let me recall contractible, it means it's non-empty, and homotopy equivalent to a point, but it's non-empty. And roughly speaking, when you have a such a space, all isotropic groups must be elements of F. And the basic result about this is, first of all, the model always exists. Actually, if you use bar constructions from homotopy, you can even get functorial models, but it's not our issue here. But the main point for us is that these spaces have a kind of universal property. And it is the following. So if X is another nice space, so a GCW complex, with isotropy entirely in F. Isotropy groups are the stabilizer groups under the action. Then you may wonder whether you have maps from X to EFG at all, and you would like to understand them up to homotopy,
geomotopy.
And the point is that this is just consists of one element. So in other words, whenever you have a GCW complex whose isotropic groups belongs to F, we will find a map from X to EFG, but up to a geomotopy, there's only one. And it's very clear that B implies automatically C up to geomotopy, two models are unique. There's only one model. And since we will apply later to the spaces only an equivalent homology theory, it doesn't really play a role which model we were using, because up to homotopy, we don't see any difference. So this is a concept which was actually invented in the 70s by Tom Deek, studying equivalent homology theories, and also plays a role in Quinn's work on group homology. But let me give you some examples that we understand this concept. Okay, let's look at the example where we look at F is trivial. Then actually what we denote like this is the standard EG. So EG can be defined as a free GCW complex, and then this definition. Yeah, that means the geomotopy classes of G maps. And the geomotopy means a homotopy, but at any time t you have a G map. This is all. And okay. One class, exactly. That's it. And yes, here, coming back to this is rather obvious, because this means that this is a GCW complex with a free action. We call this EG usually. Or you may say EG is a universal covering of BG, but I do not know what BG is. BG is the space whose fundamental group is G, and the other homotopy groups are trivial. If you take another extreme case, where you take all subgroups, and we have a very nice model, just the point. Right. So what we're trying to interpolate using F is between this EG and G mod G. And in some sense, the slogan is, this is quite interesting, even G is often very nice. So slogan. First of all, I should say that sometimes you will find the abbreviation that people call E under bar G, and it means this E fin. And sometimes they have a double under bar, they mean E virtual cycle. So what do I mean with the slogan? It means that we have, first of all, very often small models. Later we want to make computations, let's say, of cohomology or homology groups of these spaces. And if you have a few cells or a few building blocks, the better it is. But the other interesting thing is that they very often have very nice geometric models. And I would just like to give you a list. This is not true for this space. This is usually very bad in comparison with this space. And you will see one complication with the Baum-Korn conjecture and the Feld-Jones conjecture is Baum-Korn suffices to you look at this. For Feld-Jones, you will have to look at this. This makes life much harder. Yeah, maybe I give you some ideas of the spaces, because they really pop up very nicely. So I'm talking now for some time about this space, so models for E10 or E under bar G. And we also say that sometimes these spaces are called also specifying spaces for proper actions. The reason is that on the GCW complex, the action is proper exactly if all isotropic groups are finite. Okay, but why is this a really interesting spaces? Take a hyperbolic group. And then there's a so-called Ritz complex. And roughly speaking, if D is large enough, this is the model. And the good thing is the Ritz complex is always what we call a finite GCW complex, or in other words, it's built by finitely many cells, or equivalently it's co-compact. It means if you divide out the action, you get a compact space. Another interesting case is the mapping class group. And you use a Teichmuller space. And this is a model. There are some conditions, I think, G plus number of punctures plus number of bounded components must be bigger than so and so to get something hyperbolic. So nearly all mapping class groups have this property. I can figure out the number if you want to. I've forgotten to do this. We have out of N. And actually, you can take a spine of outer space, the sense of Karen and co-workers. And the spine is even also the point that is a model. And in all cases, they are co-compact. So OK, the Teichmuller space itself may not be a co-compact model, but you can find also a co-compact model for E under bar G here, as well as here and there. Another interesting example is where you have a Lie group L. They're connected. Any Lie group has automatically a maximal compact subgroup of the conjugation Lie. And then one knows that the right coset space is actually diffeomorphic to a Euclidean space. And now we have the possibility from the left side to act with G. So suppose G and L is a discrete subgroup, then LK with the left G action is a model. So these spaces are interesting in differential geometry because a lot of symmetric spaces occur in this fashion. So many things what I wanted to say. Maximal compact. Yeah, right. Suppose G acts on a cat zero space by isometries. So cat zero space is a metric space where in some sense these typical Alexandrov comparison triangles are the one you would expect from a non-positive curved is x by isometries and proper. And proper. Then this is a model. No, I don't think so. I should look up. I don't think. For the model, I think. You need some dimension on it. It's maybe I write on co-compact, and if I can say more, I will do it later. If I write co-compact, I'm the safe side. Sorry, I should look it up. I've really forgotten. And an example, a nice example, is GX on a tree. Now without inversion and all these words, this finite isotropy. And this is also a model. Yeah, maybe I rush to some keywords. I will not really continue with the list. Keyword Borel-Serre compactification. So, if you have a group which has applies to this issue, bus where is their quantification is a model, and one related groups also have very nice models. So I will stop here, because it's actually the study of the space is interesting in its own right. Also the question whether the spaces have finite dimensional models or not. It's related to the question whether the BG of a group is finite or not, which is a prominent situation. But if a group is torsion, then of course BG is always infinite dimensional, but it turns out the space E infinite G is often very, very nice. Maybe before I clean the board, let me squeeze in one example. So take the infinite hidden group. And with x on R in an obvious way, translation minus identity, this is a tree, so this is a model. But if you want to get a model for BD infinity, it has to be infinite dimensional because it contains torsion. So you see that these models for the underbudgie are much smaller and much nicer than in general if you look at EG. In some sense, I think one should not really study EG, you should always study EFinG if you want to investigate a group. And if a torsion group is torsion free, of course, this is the same. And how bad these spaces are is, let's say, illustrated by the following conjecture. Suppose we have a co-compact model for this. And this only is possible if E is already virtually cyclic. So if G is virtually cyclic, you can take G mod G. This is very co-compact. And you think that if this has a reasonable fineness condition satisfied, you have already a virtually cyclic group. So we will always expect that these models are very large and sometimes very hard to handle. But it's life in K-theory, as you will see. For the K-theory people, this is the reflexive fact that anneal groups are so complicated. That there's a model for E with a cyclic of G, which is co-compact.
What is the word? Conjecture.
It's known for many classes of groups, so it's not. It's really pretty clear that it should hold, but should indicate that it can be very hard to find those models. When there are very interesting things also when you have topological groups, who saved me just without writing down things, for instance. When you have nice disconnected groups acting on buildings, the buildings are models. I like a lot the superposition manifold, and you may look at the space of Riemannian matrices, and you let the isometry group act on this. This is a model for E under bar G. So this is very often very nice and pops up in a very obvious way. Oh, because I could go on. Just saying they're nice models. So suppose you have a group, and you don't know what the model is. You look at the Borel stair compactification, it's the model. It's always a miracle when you have a group to which you have assigned some geometrically significant space. It's always a model for this space for proper actions. Not always. Oops. If you have a torsion-free related group, it's just a presentation complex. Yeah. If you have another one, if you have a torsion here, there's a certain maximal subgroup, cyclic subgroup. You take one cell for this, and then you add some free cells. Also very nice. But if it's torsion-free, it's just a presentation complex. Okay, what I said just now corresponds to BG or EG in the first talk. Right? So we will use instead of EG or BG these spaces. Then in the first talk, we also encountered the notion of a generalized homology theory. I just have write down to write down what a geomorphism theory is, but this is more or less the obvious generalization. But nevertheless, let's write it down. So a geomorphism theory does the following. So is a functor from GCW complexes to Z-graded abelian groups and now there are certain axioms. One is the long exact sequence of a pair. So here we have to write on GCW pair. Just what you have seen from singular homology, just with these groups and feed in the W complexes of pairs. We have G homotopy invariants. This means simply two G homotopic maps induce the same on the groups. Rather important excision, and here I will write it down what it is. So suppose you have a pair of GCW complexes and you have a cellular map from one GCW complex to another. And now you may look at the homology groups of X, A. But now you can also take X and glue it to B via F. Right? So what you would get here with this notation, you write down X glued to B via F. And now this is relative to B. And this should be an isomorphism. So in this way, the excision is much better for us. Or you may also say if you have a GCW complex, which is the union of two subcomplexes with a certain intersection, you have Z Meyerbeer total sequence you're used to. That's the same. And probably in this way, Arthur will use it more often.
How do you find out a pair if you only have a given complex?
Let's say if I have this data, this is
GCW.
Yes.
What is the
functor on pairs? It's a functor on pairs. I should write down it's a functor on GCW pairs.
Okay.
Sorry. Yeah. I thought that was clear. Yeah. And also would like to have the disjoint union axiom.
Is it
G map? It would actually be a cellular G map. I'm missing a G here, absolutely. Let me write it down for make it clear. Suppose you have an arbitrary collection of GCW complexes, you would like to ensure that this map is an isomorphism. This is clear if I is finite from excision, but it's not clear if I is not finite. Therefore, you have to require this as an extra axiom. You would like to have it because this will ensure later that your homology theory is compatible with let's say, directed limits. Otherwise, you have a problem here. I will say later say a word how they are constructed, but I would now, as quick as possible, come to an isomorphism conjecture, what I call a meta-isomorphism conjecture. It's the following. It's given for a group G a family of subgroups. And some homologies here. So you have these three data. Then the prediction is that the projection from the classifying space of the family to the space G mod G, and uses isomorphisms, and you plug in your theory, you plug in your map, and this starts here. So you're comparing the homology of EFG with the homology of this space. The point.
Point
G mod G is homogeneous space G mod G.
So G acts trivially on a point, but that's the only possible action I can think of a point.
But why do you call G mod G?
Because later I will look at G mod H. You will see why. Sometimes when I write down a point, I do not know which group is acting. If I write G mod G, I know what was the group. That's a point, actually. And later we will change the group. So this is a meta-isomorphism conjecture. So what's about? Of course, you will later see that when I will specify this data, I will get all the various conjectures you know. But so how you should think about it? You should think about it as I would like to compute this here. And this becomes more complicated the bigger this the isotropic group is. So this theory is very complicated at G mod G, although it's only a point. This is where the beef is. This space looks, of course, on the first glance much larger, it's very complicated, but all isotropic groups here are lying in F. So in some sense, to get hold on this space, you only have to understand what this homology theory is doing on homogeneous spaces G mod H, where H belongs to F, and this is usually simpler. So you should think about this as a kind of induction theorem. So it tells you, you can get this value here if you understand the values for G mod H and H belongs to F. And you will see in the applications that this is really much easier to understand this than that. But of course, I have to specify now the series, otherwise the moment is an abstract, elegant, but not so far useless concept. Yeah, many. Yeah. Of course, not quite true. If I take, let me have a computer in a second. He's never fails. So, big theorem. First, I really want to mention a name. Suppose F is all groups. Then the meta conjecture is true. This is an unpublished preprint, unfortunately, only. You see, the point is I can choose this to be G or G. So then it's an empty statement. So what the state here, of course, the point is, forget the theorem, point is find F as small as possible. Actually, this is something I would like to figure out. What I can show is, suppose you have two families. And of course, now we'll have to look at 5-bit version, but let me cheat a little bit. Then it's also true for the intersection. But I do not know it for arbitrary intersections. If I would know it for arbitrary intersections, I would know there's always a smallest family of subgroups. Well, I think this is true. You give me a homology theory, there should be a smallest family of subgroups, but this meta conjecture is true. But the problem is I can only prove it, not really, because I only can show something for finite intersections, but not for arbitrary ones. But in all cases, I think you can, for instance, show that the Baum-Conn conjecture, you can't get smaller than finite cyclic, by the way, not finite, I will come to this maybe later.
And for the Fayol-Jones conjecture for K theory, the smallest family is virtually cyclic of type 1. And for L theory, it's probably just virtually cyclic. This is a good question. We are close to getting a clear answer. There's always the smallest family, but I'm lacking a complete proof so far.
You have to admit that as soon as we find a counter family, you will enlarge the
family. That's the next point. You can enlarge it drastically, as I did in this nice paper. But we only want to enlarge it a little bit. That's the state of the art. But I'm happy to say that I believe the Fayol-Jones conjecture for all virtually cyclic groups. And if someone finds a counterexample, I admit I was wrong. Yeah, right. Then I will not enlarge the family and tell the guys, come on. You've forgotten this group.
So I didn't understand your introduction
there.
How do you
use actually, maybe a little bit too early, I will give you examples where you see what it depends. When I will now make this more precise, the examples, and you will see what I'm really talking about induction. And I mean the induction you know from representation theory, for instance, Artin induction or whatever. This is this flavor. Okay. Why don't we try to figure out one more definition. Maybe do it this way. Let's do the definitions first, and then we can talk about concrete. But it has turned out that it's not a good idea to look at groups isolated. In all cases, we know that there are nice geometry theories. They are defined for all groups, and they are linked. And this is a really important observation, although the definition is not so hard. So what is an equivariant homology theory? And now you see I replace the group G by a question mark. Right? Here we had H star. Star is, of course, a variable. G is fixed. Here's a question mark. So what we are doing is it assigns to any discrete group a homology theory. But these are now linked, so they are not arbitrary. Its slogan is coming with an induction structure. This induction structure means roughly the following. Given the homomorphism of groups, and now it's a W complex over the group H. And then we get maps. And now I want to link the homology of X as an H space. But now you can always induce up a space to a G space just by balanced product construction. And I can apply, of course, now my theory a G to it. And there should be a nice map called induction. Of course, there are certain axioms which and in particular, one axiom is if the kernel of alpha x3 on x, this is an iso. And let's say an observation. If you want to plug in a homogeneous space, but homogeneous space is the induction for the inclusion of H and G of a point. This is the same as looking at this. It becomes crucial later.
And the point is the building blocks for G-space are these homogeneous spaces, but they are computed where you apply your theory to points. Okay, now let's go to examples. So far it was a little bit abstract, probably. For instance, if X itself is free, then you can go to the quotient space.
So
typo. Oh, typo. Only one. No, but here?
No, that's right. The one below should be the same.
It's all, I call this alpha star of X, sorry. For me, Dutch is alpha star, yeah. You can cut this out of the video. Yes, right. We should also write down the other consequence. X is free. G is W complex. And we can compute this here by taking the quotient and evaluating your homology theory at a trivial group. Because induction with a projection from G to a trivial group corresponds to taking a quotient. That's very useful and will actually explain later why we have this BG in the other conjectures where you would expect an ET. But now let's come to examples. So how do you get the Baum-Conn conjecture? You choose your theory H of G to be what is called equivariant topological K theory. So there is a perfect theory defined before Kasparov already, I don't know, but with Kasparov, you get a very nice homology theory satisfying these axioms. It's only defined for proper spaces, but ignore this fact. I take the family to the finite groups, and then the meta conjecture reduces to the Baum-Conn conjecture. So in other words, Baum-Conn predicts.
So what is H of a
trip? This is some geomology theory, some equivariant homology theory. But I would say it's this one, a specific one. No, just an equivalent homology theory, but I, for the Baum-Conn conjecture, it's a specific one I have to take. So when I'm talking about the only difference between Baum-Conn and Feld-Jones is, I will just take different theories, and you always apply the meta conjecture, and you get the right conjectures out.
I think I'm asking a question
about
the previous
one.
Is there a condition on H trivial?
No. It's just an ordinary homology theory without X. So let me spell it out. So you get a map from here to here. And this is actually this case here, we also reduce this algebra. Because the point of this theory is that if you evaluate it at a homogeneous space, it gives you the case here, we also reduced C star algebra of H. So roughly speaking, if you want to understand the left side, you only have to understand the values here, but not for G, only for the H's appearing in fin, for all finite subgroups. So roughly speaking, if I understand the K theory of reduced C-star algebras for all finite subgroups of G, I understand the left side. And since this is an isomorphism, I understand the right side. So that means this is an induction theorem which tells you how to compute the value of a very complicated functor for a big group G by only looking at finite subgroups, for instance. Yeah, that's good, because then we got back to the torsion version, you see? Suppose G is torsion free. Then we have this thing here, and now I can plug in EG. So there's a free space. But now remember, it's a free space, and I told you
oh, this is just Kn of Bg. This was exactly what was my source in the Baum-Conn conjecture for torsion-free groups. Because for a torsion-free group, E-fin is Eg, the action is free, I can divide it out, I'm landing down on Kn of Bg. So this is the reason why the torsion-free case, which I presented in the first lecture, is indeed an absolute special case of this conjecture in general. What happens for Feld-Jones? And of course, I have to distinguish between K-theory and L-theory. So there is an homology theory. I will not go through the construction. The following properties. Now, it depends on the ring R you're talking about. Of course, that's Feld-Jones type of ring. And then I would like to have, again, an assembly map from here to here, given by the projection which I have. And the point of this theory is that if I evaluate it in a homogeneous space, it gives me exactly the things I would like to consider. So I will always adapt the homology theory I'm using in the Baum-Conn or the conjectures, so that if you plug in G mod H, I'm getting the functor I'm interested in. Here it was the algebraic case here of the group ring. Here it was the topological case here of the reduced C-star algebra. And for L, of course, I do it only formally. There's an L theory construction of this. I will not go through this in detail. And here the property is actually, Arthur, this all you need, right? I don't need to, you need the construction of the homology theory at all, right? So we can use this, that's enough. Or do we? This comes later, yeah, sure, I know. Just a word. This is not the end of the story. So, for instance, you can plug in other functors. The main prominent examples are, for instance, A theory of a classifying space of a group, pseudo-isotopic spaces, topological cyclic homology, topological cyclic homology. You get these functors constructed, these homology theories, and you get for each of these its own isomorphism conjecture where the family F varies with the functor I'm starting with. And this has also been examined. So it's really more than Baum-Conn and Feld-Jones going on here. Before I come, yeah, maybe should we do the transitivity principle in time. Maybe I do this first, and I've done this, and I will tell you some more about how you attack a proof. How can you attack now an isomorphism conjecture when you have this abstract statement?
So what's a simple example where some equivariant where the space?
For instance, if you, of course, you may not want to do this, but why don't you take the algebraic case theory of the reduced this algebra? Is it also topological? There is a multi theory. But this conjecture is not true for the final family. Or what I would like to do is to look at the algebraic case here of the von Neumann algebra of G, completely wrong. So there are situations where the right side has no homology flavor. You see, what these theorems are telling you is you have a very complicated functor which seems to have no homology behavior. On the left side, you have homology behavior. So that is the miracle about these isomorphism conjectures. They're telling you something which doesn't look like a multi-theory, is a multi-theory. And actually, the proof we will describe has to do with this kind of tension. In some sense, a proof works morally like you have this functor, give me a reason why it's a multi-theory, and then we get a proof out of this. But that will come this in, at the end. And now, of course, Arthur will be more precise later. But let me first state the transitivity principle, because Arthur needs it. actually what I would probably not do is just saying there is something. There are versions with coefficients with additive D categories where you can allow a group limits with a twisting, you can allow an L-theory orientation characters, you can twist your group sister algebra with a GC star algebra. I think it's not worthwhile to give you the details here, but there are more advanced versions. Actually, these advanced versions, they are the ones which have these nice inheritance properties. So these plain ones where you just put in the sister algebra of a group itself, they are not so nice. So you should go to the more general versions, but again, I think your explanation, this will also be a black box, and we don't have to say anything about it. So I would like to spare these things. But the transitivity principle is important. And this has now to do with the question which Eric always was raising, can I make the family smaller? First of all, one important observation, suppose you have a small family sitting inside a bigger family. Then up to homotopy, you have always exactly one map from the classifying space of F to the classifying space of G. Now you have to remember the definition or the universal property. The property here was that if you have any GCW complex whose isotropy lies in here, there's up to G homotopy precisely one map from this GCW complex here. But EFG, forget its classifying property, has isotropic groups in F, hence in G, so there's exactly one map from here to here. So the question is, so we would like to know, when is this map, or you take this iota F G, an isomorphism? This will pop up several times when we were talking about proofs. The reason is, I will say more about proofs later, but the proof is that the group acts nicely on a space. And if the isotropic groups would be, for instance, the Bonpon setting all finite, you would have directly the Bonpon conjecture. Or if the isotropic groups are virtually cyclic, you sometimes have directly the Feld-Jones conjecture. But it could be, and very often at infinity, your isotropic groups are larger. And then you, of course, you will prove the desired conjecture, not for the family of virtually cyclic subgroups. You will prove it for the isotropic groups which appear at the boundary. And then you will apply this principle finally to come down to virtually cyclic groups by applying this. So what does it mean? This is a question. It's an isomorphism. The answer is yes, is the following hold. In some sense, you have to know that this statement is true for any subgroup here with respect to the family F restricted. So let me write down the statement first, namely, for every possible group in G, and now I'm taking the family, the big one, and restrict it to F. In the obvious sense, I just look at subgroups of H which lie in the big family. And now the isomorphism conjecture just should hold for this family. You see here, this is exactly an isomorphism conjecture for this specific family for this group H. So in passing from this larger group to the smaller group, you have to, in some sense, to prove the isomorphism conjecture for all elements in here with respect to this group there. Here's an example. Let's study Baum-Conn. And look at the inclusion of Finn to virtually cyclic. So actually, in some sense, a virtually cyclic is a natural class of groups. It's more natural than Finn if you look at the proofs. some sense. But it's a computation by the Baum-Conn conjecture only has to use this finite subgroups. Let's apply this. So what I have to check? For H, A, and G, means for any virtually cyclic group, I have to check. So I would like to show that on K-theory, this map is always an ISO. Which explains why I can really look at a smaller family. This is true. So I unravel what is staying here. It means for any virtually cyclic the corresponding assembly map here is an ISO. In other words, since I know that the Baum-Conn conjecture respect to the family of finite subgroups holds for all virtually cyclic subgroups, I actually get this map is already an isomorphism. And this here actually is an easy consequence of this result of Primitz-Novoi-Colescu. If you remember, I have written down certain exact sequences, and you can get this here. So as I said, you will use this principle again. So when Arthur says, I apply transitivity principle like a magic stick, the transitive principle. This is some way of reducing from a larger family to a smaller family. And remember, this will occur because in some of the proofs, first of all, you can only prove it for a larger family than the family you would like to have. And then you have to apply an extra argument to get to the small family. Okay, I have 5 minutes. Now let me give you a glimpse. How you can prove this. So maybe I will see it one. Example first. The Fell-Jones conjecture says for a group G, or implies, I should say, and let's see, and coefficients C, the following. You may want to compute K0 of CG. And then you can do it by computing K0 of CH for all finite subgroups. Well, this is the reason why it's the kind of call of induction theorem, right? You only have to understand the values for finite subgroups. You must collect them depending on the lattice of finite subgroups in your big group. And if you group them together, you get this theorem. But this is a very nice example because, in general, you will have what is called degree mixing. It could be that K0 is affected by K-4. This is something you always have to have in mind, that it's not always in the same dimension. It could be that K1 is affected by K0 and so on. Just as an example why we call this induction theorems as well. So now, ideas of proof. Of course, very sketchy, but I think. So suppose I want to compute, prove the Borel conjecture for something. This would be the statement. There are two ways now. Of course, you have different attacks. The Baum-Conn people would use Kasparov products and the dual Dirac method. Because this gives you also maps out of K-theory.
Homotopy theorists will use trace maps, essentially, getting from KC to something which you can better understand, and where you can, for instance, show that this composite is injective, and you would get injectivity. The problem is, no one really knows how to construct a map from here to here directly. This is really the problem why you really have some of the homotopy theoretic approaches are good, but they are usually not very useful for bijectivity. But now look at the philosophy here again. This here has no homology flavor. This does. And also think of the Baum-Kondt conjecture. You have here this K theory, and here you have this K homology theory. Usually K theory can be described by cycles. I'm not saying what a cycle is. It could be in the topological, in the star world, an operator on a manifold. Here it could be an element in a certain geometric module or whatsoever. But here you have this homological flavor. So the question is, what's the difference between the left and the right side? And the difference is excision. So the question is, why do we have excision? But this is some sense in the homotopy invariant functor, it's fine, but excision is unclear. And now go back to the proof why singular homology is a homology theory. There, of course, how do you prove excision? You have two open sets which cover your space. And a cycle, of course, is essentially given by singular symplices. And you can get excision because you can subdivide it. And subdivision makes the symplices so small, it's either lie in the left or in the right set. This is the reason why excision works. So excision means essentially, slogan is make cycles small. That's the idea of proof. In some sense, this is the first anchor where you see, ah, now I can use geometry. Because either you do very homotopy theoretic, which we don't want to do on this conference, but suppose you have a nice description of a cycle, find a way how you can change the presenting cycle without changing the class, but making it small. Here you have a solution. And the singular homology, you just make subdivision. And what we will use is this one nice method. This will become more clear later. What we very often use is look at hyperbolic space. And look at some geometric object. And I want to make it smaller, but in a, let's say, homotopy theoretic independent way, so in a smooth way. Take a point at infinity, now let this flow to this point. And indeed, the picture is not really misleading. The object becomes smaller and smaller. But on the other hand, you see it's a kind of continuous process, so you are not surprised that the object, the cycle, whatever it is, still gives you the same class, but you're making it smaller and smaller. Okay, very vague, but how do you get control about it? Now an example. Let's say, look at the H cobordism. That would be a manifold. It's two boundary components. So that the left and the right inclusion are homotopy equivalences. And you would like to understand whether this is trivial or not. But of course, you have handle body decompositions, which I try to indicate like this. You attach handles. And now comes a point. You can either forget the handles and look at them purely algebraically, so you would go to the cellular chain complex, or you remember where the handle had sit. So, of course, it's not so clear where it sits, but you choose some point in the handle and say, yeah, the handle sits here and there. This will lead Arthur to say a notion of a geometric module where you have a module with a basis, but the basis is attached to points in your space. And then the idea is,
change your space so that later the algebra gives you a zero in K theory whatsoever. And a pre-shadow of this is, for instance, a result if these handles are very small. This is automatically a trivial H cobordism. This is one of the theorems, maybe Quinn or whatsoever, saying whenever this you can make it so small as you want, then you have a trivial H cobordism a priori. This was a pre-shadow for me. I think we may talk about it. I don't know. Alpha approximation theorem? No. Okay. There are some theorems, of course, which lead to the Fair-Jones conjecture. Another very nice one is the one of Ferrer and Chapman. They say when you have a multiple equivalence between manifolds, and going hence and first and look at the tracks of the multiples, they're very, very small, it's already a homeomorphism. Right, this kind of effect like Borel conjecture, something is homotopy equivalent, it turns to be homeomorphic because you control how the changes happen in a multiple of the algebra. And what Arthur will try to present is, what is our geometric modules, having this picture in mind? What do we need to make changes on these pictures? You won't, not? You maybe, okay. And then you see something how geometry gives you the way of proving this kind of isomorphisms. And as I told you, the slogan, surreativity is enough for bijectivity. And this is the same slogan here. Because you have an element in the here. Well, okay. You don't understand. But you can find something here because this you can think of what is called a forget control map. So this has description in cycles. This has descriptions in cycles which are very small. And now you see what you have to do. You have to gain control on these cycles and find some geometric methods to make something small here without changing the class. And if you have surjectivity, a cycle is a boundary, you apply your argument in a relative situation and you get injectivity more or less for free. Okay. Now you understand everything. Yeah, yes, there are ideas. It's very interesting that what is controlled topology for topology has to do with controlled algebras, you may say, in the Baum-Kahn setting. And I would say that for a long time, both communities didn't know that they were doing similar things. When you should not think that you can transfer the one method to the other, unfortunately not. I have some hope that we may transfer Fair-Jones methods to Fréchier algebras. It would be nice. But the Baum-Kahn world has something we cannot do. They have analysis. They have Kasparov products. On the Fair-Jones conjecture, you will have transfers, which are not existent there. And this kind of tension shows that the methods of proofs are in some sense similar, but on the other hand also, on the same time, quite different. But they're also very geometric. I don't know whether Nigel could say more about what kind of geometric things you would need to prove the Baum-Kahn conjecture. You would also come up with things which I would say are in this flavor, at least. Arthur will talk about. So there is a similarity, but it's not really one-to-one. But it's amazing how these geometric methods are really the main important tools for proving this conjectures which come from homotopy theory. Right? For me, algebra K theory is an homotopy theoretic thing, an algebraic thing. But the proofs, the good proofs we know today, maybe somebody will have another idea, are always geometric usually. And as I said, the homotopy theoretic proofs are nice. They give you more examples, but they usually only give you injectivity. It is a big achievement, but not the full package. Well, I suggest, because we have a coffee break, we have anyway enough time for discussions later, that we have made now the break. Arthur will start in 25 minutes. I would also give you one explanation. This kind of notion, free slots, talks, and discussion means you can do what you want. But if we think that we find out that you would like to see something specific, and you must tell it me or Romain so that we can organize maybe an extra session on any topic which is interesting for you, or repetition. You would like to understand something in more detail. But as long as you don't tell us what you would like to see, well, you will just have free time. That's of course very temptating, but we'll see. Okay.